वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं गुरुब्रह्मा गुरुविष्णु गुरुदेवो महेश्वर गुरुसाक्षात् परब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे I welcome everyone who are in the temple as well as who are online. Today on 7th of October, we are going forward in Jai Durga temple for study what we are doing for the Shrimad Bhagavad Gita. We have been studying it for quite a few days and we are on the second chapter, 56th verse. And we were looking at it last time. We started it. We recaptured some of the things. So I will first chant the sloka and then we will go further with the meaning. Dukeshvanu dvigna manaha sukeshu vigata spruha vitaraga bhaya krodha sthita dhirmuni ruchyate. Dukeshvan anudvigna manaha. This is what we were looking at last time. The person whose mind remains undisturbed amidst the misery, adversary, dukkha, uncomfort, non-convenience, all those things we call as dukkha. And sukeshu vigata spruha, the craving for the pleasure is gone and the disturbance of mind due to the adversary is not disturbed, the mind is not disturbed. And who is a person? And vita raga bhaya krodha. Vita means gone. The person whose greed, whose bhaya, the fear and the anger is gone. That is a person who is a sitadhir muni ruchyate, whose intellect is steadfast. This is what it is telling. And we were doing the analysis of dukkha and sukha last time. And we will go further on it. So when this sloka is told by the God, that dukheshu anudvigna manaha, it is very much evident and it is visible that God is telling us that there will be dukkha and sukha in our life. There will not be a single situation where there will not be any dukh in our life or any sukh in our life for that matter. Because when the dukh is happening, we think that there is not going to be any happiness. And then we get happiness also. So it is going to come in everyone's life. This is a main thing we have to understand in our mind, conclude, convince and agree to it. That there will be a dukkha and sukha, there will be a pleasure and there will be a misery. There will be convenient and inconvenient situation in our life every day. It is an unavoidable thing and there are multiple reasons for it. So we will not go into the reason, but we will go into the understanding. That first part is that God is telling us very clearly that we are not going to have only dukkha or sukha in our life. There will be dukkha and sukha together in our life. There is not a single person in the world who has got only dukkha, and there is not a single person who has got only sukha. There is always a combination. Even a beggar who is having no money, no house, nothing, when the beggar gets a $10 currency note while he's begging, he becomes happy. The state of mind of that person at that given moment is happy, is happiness. Oh, today I got a $10 current note. So happiness is not, or even sorrow is not dependent on a person's situation. A very poor person can be very happy and a very rich person can be very sad or dukhi. So God has given us, all of us, these both things. This is to be understood and agreed to. When that comes, 95% of the solution is already achieved, because once we agree to a situation, then we will not fight against it, but we will go with the flow. Whatever comes, we will accept it. And then there is law of karma and everything. We will go further. When we go further in the Gita, we will understand. So number one is, God is explaining there will be always a dukkha and sukha in your life. Right? And misery or discomfort is dukkha, and comfort and pleasure is sukha. Is a general understanding. But it is not exactly the thing. So let us go a little bit in detail of what is dukkha or sukha. Let us take an example of, say, smoking, for example. The cigarette, which gives a great pleasure to a person, will give a lot of suffocation and coughing to a person who doesn't smoke. So these are the bullet points, you know, like you can write down the bullet points in your mind or even in paper if you're writing it. That sukha and dukkha is not object dependent. It is not dependent on the object. If the object is giving the happiness, then the same cigarette will give happiness, equal happiness to everyone. It's not that. In the same way, the amount of object, like smoking 2 cigarettes or 5 cigarettes, is also going to give different happiness to different people. So it is not that the happiness is in the cigarette, but happiness is connected to the person. This is a very important part. Then it also depends on the prakruti of a person. So the nature by which we are built, the body which we have got, the metabolism by which our body is working, is also going to give us the feeling of happiness and sorrow. Say, for example, if there is an air conditioner, a person is finding it very hot, so he is starting an air conditioner in the room. But there is another person who doesn't find that hot. So when the air conditioner is started, in the same room being each of them, one person will find happiness that, oh, now I am comfortable, and the other person will find it colder, he will be unhappy. So the sukha and dukkha is also dependent and connected with our prakruti. So if we go against our prakruti, then it becomes a dukkha. And if it goes along the prakruti, it becomes a sukha. This, in long run, is getting connected to the varna vyavastha. If my nature is to protect and govern like a kshatriya, I should not become a computer science engineer. And I should not do a job, because my prakruti doesn't jive with my profession. So, we have talked about it a while ago also. So, depending on our prakruti, we will find a situation or an object, either a sukha or dukha, a favorable or non-favorable. Then we also looked at the phase of life. When a little girl is finding a great pleasure in playing with the doll, a same girl, when grows older, doesn't find pleasure playing with the doll. Why? Because her situation is changed. Her age is changed. Her position is changed. She has grown up. Her state of mind has changed. So, with the same thing, we do not get the equal pleasure. That girl will not get equal pleasure what she used to get during her childhood. In the same way, as we know in the law of diminishing value of the objects, like when we are very hungry, the first bite which we take of the food is really enjoyable and most pleasure. But after we completely eat and somebody tells us to eat the same food, we will be having a great displeasure in it. Why? Because there is a diminishing value of money. The diminishing value the law of utilization. So what happens is that, and that is the reason why somebody says that, oh, if I have got $1 million, I will be the happiest person in life. But when that person gets $1 million and you ask him, he will say, yeah, it's okay, now I got $1 million, but I will be happier if I get $2 million. So this shows that a person's stage of life, the phase of life, the aspirations also is impacting the feeling of pleasure or sadness. Then it is also dependent on the future situation. Let us take an example. Suppose there is a village. In that village there is a guy who is living with a, you know, he's a very rich person, bada seth, you know, he's a very rich person, he's living there. But village has got a problem of dacoits. You know, the dacoits come and then they loot the people and they kill the people. So, say one dacoit is there and coming in the village and putting a note on the door of this rich man, the door of the house of this rich man where he's living, and he's telling, tonight at 12 o'clock we are going to come and we are going to loot you and kill you. There is a tag on the door that tonight we are going to come. Now when this man comes in the evening after doing lots of good business and lots of money and everything, earning money, and this is a big house, he is a very rich man, he is reading the note. When he is reading the note, he is worried. He may call police, he may call security, whatever he wants to do, he can do. And now those security people tell him that, okay, don't worry, we are here, we are going to defend you, you go and you sleep in your bed comfortably, no problem. What will happen? Will that person be able to sleep comfortably? It is the same bed. It is the same very expensive bed, $10,000 mattress on it, golden bed, made out of $2 million, you know, wood and metal and all those gold and everything. It is the same bed he's sleeping. Will he be able to sleep? No. He will be worried. So, being in a situation doesn't really, which makes you happy, doesn't always keep you happy because of the future conditions, because the thoughts of the future. So so even our happiness is also dependent on it. Then there is a happiness dependent on the comparison. Suppose a guy has got a latest mobile of say iPhone. A person buys a latest mobile of iPhone, you know, some model. I don't know what is the latest one, but the person buys it. Very expensive. He is looking at it. This guy, young guy, student, he is very happy. He is very happy with the mobile phone. He is thinking, oh, I got the latest. He will show it to the friends. Now after 6 months, a year, a new model comes up. And now he is showing this a phone to his friend. See, I got this phone 8 months ago. And the friend will show, I got the latest one. This is the older version. And this guy is now thinking, oh no, I got the older version. I do not have the latest version. This is very practical happening in everybody's life. We must have seen all the kids generally, you know, those who are like mobile phone savvy. And then they will say that, oh, I need a new phone. Why do you need a new phone? Your work is going correctly. There is nothing wrong with the phone. It is working perfectly fine. But he is sad. He is in a displeasure. He is not in a good mood. Why? Because now I have got an older model. The model which was giving them happiness is now not there, not giving them the happiness, because by comparison, when we compare our situation, status, power, possession, whatever we have, when we compare it with the other person, other people, and other situations, we become unhappy. So it is not only object based, it is also based on the situation and relative term. So sukh and dukh is also a relative term. This is another part. But so in general, what we understand is that there are a lot of variables in sukh and dukh. So if we imagine that we are going to be happy in a given situation and we strive to get that, it is not necessary that we always get happiness from that situation. It is not necessary. When I was a young boy, suppose somebody will say, I will think that, oh, the only pleasure, so when I will grow old, because mama will tell, you go, you put your, you know, I was reading all the comics at that time, you know, all those comic books and everything. So, I like to eat sweets. And mama will say, no, you do not eat that much sweet. It too much sweet, eating too much sweet is not good for health. Mama will say that you don't only read comics, you read some also your study books. I can't do what I want to do. So I am unhappy. So then I think that when I will grow old, I will only read comics and I will only eat sweets. When I have money, when I will earn my own money. But when I earn my own money, I understand that reading comics continuously doesn't help. It doesn't give me the same happiness. So there are so many variables, situation, our prakriti, position in the in a given time, depending on the person, by comparison, by future aspirations, by future fears, all these things are variables, and that is why a human is running and running continuously in the search of happiness, in the search of sukha. But they will never get that sukha because that sukha is kshanik. You may get happiness at a given moment, but the same thing will not give you same happiness at a next moment. So this is so much depressing, isn't it? It seems like, oh my God, it is so depressing. I will never have happiness in my life. I will always be unhappy in my life. No, but there is other side of coin also. Suppose there is a dukkha. There is a story of Akbar and Birbal. You know, Akbar was a king, emperor, and Birbal was his minister. So there is a story that Akbar was having a birthday. And on his birthday, Birbal gave him a gift of a ring. He gave him a ring, golden ring, to him, to Akbar. And when Akbar wear it and Akbar sees the ring, Akbar is saying that it is written on it, Ye din bhi jayenge, these days will also go. This time will go. This time will also go. Ye din bhi jayenge, this time also, this time also will go. It was written on the ring. And now you imagine that a person is very happy, a person is celebrating the birthday, and now we are having a gift coming up, and the gift is telling that Ye din bhi jayenge, these days will go. Is that a good wish on a birthday? It doesn't seem to be a good wish. We are telling that you are so happy now, but this happiness will go. So Akbar was very unhappy that, oh, this is not a good ring. The ring is okay, diamond or metal is okay, gold, but the writing on it is not good. But he took it, he knew that Birbal is very intelligent and his friend, so maybe there is something good in it. So he was wearing the ring. Now one day, Akbar was going in, the days passed, Akbar went to the forest for hunting. And he got lost. He got lost in forest and he was moving around, he was searching for water and food, he was so tired, he was totally no energy, he was enervated. And he was in a very difficult situation. He thought that, oh my God, I am the emperor. And now look at it, what situation I am in. He was completely discouraged. He was completely hopeless that he can ever come out of that forest. And then he saw, look at the ring, and the ring was telling, Ye din bhi jayenge, these days will also pass. And he suddenly recollected that, aha, so just like, during the birthday party, I was happy, and now I am in this situation, these days will also go. So that means there is a hope. We all know the Pandora's story, that all the pain, all the sadness, all the disease, everything came out of Pandora's box. But then there is a hope. The last fairy which came out of the box was the hope. That hope will take a person through all the miseries. Through all the miseries. So, It is not that, oh, all this sukha will be not be there and I will not be happy with what I am. It is also on the same side, dukkha also, that when a person is in a great misery, the person knows that this time will go and I will get a happiness someday. Now, let us do some scientific analysis of happiness. So what is happening, that actually the happiness has been, by the physicist, the doctors have identified that how does a person become happy? What happens in the body of a person when the person becomes happy? So there is a chemical, and the name of the chemical is dopamine. When a person comes with in contact to a object through the senses, or a person is in a situation like listening to a good music, meeting a friend, hugging the children, reading a good book, visiting the temple, anytime, any experience, making a good business through the day, the feeling of happiness is physically observed as the chemical of dopamine. This chemical is a neurotransmitter produced by the hypothalamus, a gland. The hypothalamus is a small region of the brain which is oozing the liquid which is called as dopamine, and that dopamine is giving the feeling of happiness in the mind of a person. This is a total physiology. All the physiologists has identified that this is happening. So what they have tried is that why not to take that dopamine and inject it into the person's body. So artificially, when they got that chemical dopamine and they injected it into the body of a person, the person, without any reason, without any contact with the object through the senses, or without any reason, person become very happy. This is the physiology part of the happiness. And same for the sorrow, there is another chemical problem. So dopamine, so what doctors told, that if somebody is too much depressed, somebody is thinking that I want to die, I want to suicide, there is no happiness in my life, then give them this chemical. And then there are researching on the medicines and all that, how to make a person happy. So somebody say, aha, that is the path of happiness. No, the point is that in a non-medical situation, what is creating to generate dopamine in our mind is a question. A smoker, when he's smoking the cigarette, he gets a little dopamine in the mind, which gives him the pleasure, the feeling of pleasure. But a non-smoker is not getting that dopamine. So the cause of dopamine is unknown. And that is what we say, that the God gives you happiness and the God gives you sorrow. The karma ka phal aapko sukh ya dukh deta hai. That is what in Hindi I will say. Karma phal ko svikar karo. Jab aap svikar karoge, to aapko wo dukh ya sukh ka anubhav nahi karne dega. That is what it is. So what happens is that when we get that the reason for the dopamine to ooze out in the hypothalamus the gland or the portion of the brain is still unknown. This is the physiological part, because there may be some doctors who are listening. So physiological part of happiness is because of the dopamine. And also the feeling is related to expense, the expectation. So suppose a person goes to the business and he's thinking, today I'm going to make $200,000, but the person makes only $150,000. Even with $150,000, because the target is not met, the person becomes unhappy. So it is dependent on so many things. But basically, the common denominator is that sukha and dukha is a state of mind. And so the God has told that dukheshwa anudvigna manaha. The state of mind should not get disturbed. The dukkha and sukha will keep on coming. We analyze all those dukkha and sukha, relativity of it with the thing. But we are not focusing. So changing anything will be apple polishing. Yeah. Say, and then you know what? People will say, oh, this is too much theoretical. It is not theoretical. It is totally practical. We are, say for example, even in country, we are telling that having unemployment resolved, there should not be any unemployment. Yes, I agree with it. I do not disagree with it. But everybody having a job will make the society happy. Is it possible? The happiness will depend on the employment. Yeah, it will fetch you bread and butter maybe, but it will not get you happy. If that is the case, then all the Hollywood big stars who have suicided by getting lots of drug would never have happened. They had lot of money. So happiness doesn't, we are all politically, everywhere, we are telling that providing more resources, bountiful resources to the society will make the society happy. And that is an incorrect assumption, because even the richest society in the world has found lot of people extremely unhappy. So what is the solution? And the solution is in Gita. So we will come to that. We'll go further, because we can keep on talking on this, but the thing is, the resources doesn't bring happiness. It is the state of mind which will give us happiness or unhappiness. So the question is, how do we get that state of mind? In what way we will be in a state of mind which will be having sthitadhi muni ruchyate, it will be having an undisturbed mind in the case of happiness as well as sorrow as well as happiness. Yeah, that is it. So we have to understand it. Now there is one more factor in it, is the unhappiness of today or the misery of today, dukkha, is happiness of tomorrow. We have to remember that. So that is why people go through unhappiness. Like for example, people do the exercise. Today I am sweating, my heart is beating heavy, and I am doing a lot of workout, for example. It gives me a lot of uncomfort and difficulty to my body. But I know that it is going to give me happiness tomorrow, because I will be more healthier. Similarly, leaving smoking, delivering the babies. Delivering a baby is considered as the highest level of pain in the world. Second one is the toothache. But the first one is delivering the baby, the highest level of pain. Why do all our mothers have taken that pain to see our face? So today's pain is reward for tomorrow, and people take the pain voluntarily. Yeah. Now, do we need sukha or dukha? First of all, why God has created it, or why it is required? It is required to push the society further. If there is no sukha or dukha, there will be no society. The society will not work. People who are dukhi will try to get the sukha. The people who are having sukha, the people who are having pleasure and convenience, will try to maintain it and get more. This keeps the society running. So if there is a place where there is no sukha and no dukha, the society will stop working. Think about it. So it is absolutely necessary that there is a sukha and dukha in the society. Somebody will say, oh my God, people should give a blessing. Huh. You go to a Panditji, or you go to a person, you go to a great sage, and what will you ask? Except one person in Mahabharata, I have heard, and I am not very much agreeing with it, but except one person, everybody in the world goes and asks for sukha only. Nobody asks for dukha. It is only one person in Mahabharata, it is stated, that Kunti, the mother of Pandava, she told Krishna that I want dukha in my life so that I can remember it. Because in sukha, I may forget it. Personally, I don't agree with that, because it is a depressing way of remembering. If I can remember the God in sukha also, what is wrong in it? Why should I always have a dukha to remember the God? In sukha also remember the God. So, but I will leave that point separate. Basically, we all ask for sukha. We all ask for it. That is pushing the life further. And that is why we need sukha and dukha both in the society. So somebody will say, oh, you are asking for dukha? Yes. Because dukha will push the people to strive for better. Doing exercise is dukha, but to get a better health is sukha. So today's dukha is tomorrow's sukha. Living smoking is dukkha for a smoker today, but tomorrow he has a healthy life. So we must have dukkha and sukha in the society. We must have. Now there is one more part in it, that somebody will say that not having sukha and dukkha. So there are two states of mind. This is extremely important, and I repeatedly tell in many of my pravachans. This is extremely important part. I will go a little slow in it. So now this dukkha and sukha is going to be there. There are two states of mind. One path told by one big person is that the path of nirvana. There should not be any feeling of sukha and dukkha in the mind of a person. When you achieve nirvana, you get sukha and dukkha. You get the pleasure and misery equal in your mind. Nirvana. I am untouched by misery or happiness. Nirvana. Sanatana Dharma doesn't agree with that. And there are two reasons. Sanatana Dharma, so people, what they are, no, Sanatana Dharma believes in the moksha and not in nirvana. Let us talk about the nirvana part, because that is one of a very big incorrect road through which many of the Sanatana Dharma believers are also still, you know, thinking about that line. When we achieve nirvana, there is no impact of dukkha and sukha in the mind of a person. When there is no impact, the person doesn't react. Imagine that a person gets a dukkha and the person doesn't react to it, the person will keep getting dukkhi. And in turn, the whole samaj, the whole society will become like that. The impact of the dukkha and sukha must be there. In case of a nirvana, the impact of sukha and dukkha is not there. Sadhu. Mujhe sukh ya dukh ki mujhe lagta hi nahi. If everybody does like that, then the society will stop. So what should be there? The impact of the sukha and dukha, the impact of the convenience and inconvenience, misery and pleasure should be there. The sensing, the feeling of sukha and dukha must be there. But because of that, the disturbance of the mind should not be there. That is what God is telling here. Dukheshva anudvigna manaha means your mind should not get disturbed by the situation. In other words, the mind is sensing it. You sense it, but you don't get disturbed. This is a faint line, but extremely important line. Because if I do not sense it, I will not react to it. The world will stop. So I must sense it, but it should not disturb my mind. An udvigna manaha, man udvigna nahi hona chahiye, means man ke upar effect ka hui na. Unless there is a sensing in the man about the sukha and dukha, man will not react to it. So sensing should be there, but disturbance should not be there. This should be very clearly understood, because the whole path of nirvana is telling to stop the sensing. That should not be. It is an incorrect path. The Sanatana Dharma talks about the moksha and not the nirvana, which is called in another religions. So we have to be very careful on that, because otherwise we will become inactive. So many invaders, the result of that is what? So many invaders came to India, invaded the country, looted the resources and all the treasures and everything, killed the people, took away all the women and children, and we didn't react to it. We took it as a law of karma. We told that, okay, it is a dukkha, take it as it is. We didn't react to it. The power of resistance, the power of action, the power of resolving the situation, is only when anudvigna mana situation anudvigna mana is achieved and not nirvana. Nirvana is not the path. So God is not telling here about nirvana. We have to be careful on that point. Dukesho anudvigna manaha means our mind should get the sense of it, but it should not get disturbed by it. In nirvana, there is no sense at all. We will talk. Look at that example. In a few moments. So the thing is, at least we understood here that escaping the misery is not possible. So face it. And somebody will say, okay, how this whole theory you are talking is practically applicable? Well, you know, today's biggest two problems. You go to a doctor and you ask, what are the today's biggest two big problems? Not the disease, but what are the two biggest problems of our society as of today now in North America? One is obesity. Look at it. Look around. Diet plan, yoga, this, that, all. Why? Because, I am obese. I am overweight. I am having this problem. And this obesity is creating the problem of cholesterol and diabetes and heart issues and, you know, all those things are because of one thing, which is obesity. And the second problem is depression. For every three person, there is one psychiatrist. Why? Because there is a depression. People are depressed. These are two major problems of North America today, obesity and depression. Actually, obesity is also cause of depression only. When a person is depressed, they will try to offset that unhappiness with the food, and that is why they become obese. And both of these is happening because the impact of dukkha and sukha is in the mind of a person. Anudvigna manaha is not happening. The disturbance is happening. And because of that, the person becomes depressed and then obese. So this sloka is actually teaching us how not to go into that ditch, into that, you know, a wrong path of obesity or depression. By understanding the acceptance of dukkha and sukha. Yeah. So we'll go further on this. I think we have taken enough on this one to understand what exactly and what not to do also. The nirvana path, we should go through the moksha path. But we will go to the second stanza here. Vita raga bhaya krodha. Vita. Vita means gone. One whose raga, the greed, bhaya, the fear, and krodha, the anger. One whose raga, bhaya, and krodha, greed, fear, and anger is gone. Vita. Vita means gone. Vita raga bhaya krodha. You are free from. You are free from greed. You are free from anger. You are free from fear. So we will ask the question, same question, because we are doing study here. We will ask the question. So we always listen. Moha chhod do. Yes. We always get a... You listen to any big talk, we are always told, moha chhod do. Greed chhod do. Raag chhod do. Moha chhod do. So I'll talk about a story. That is the raag, is the greed necessary? If it is wrong, why did God create it, first of all? So then, you know, somebody will say, nahi, Bhagwan ne maya banai. Bhagwan made a illusion. Delusion. So that we are, you know, we are distracted, and those kind of things are told. So let us, but first of all, take an example of raga, greed, attachment. Raga is attachment. So should we have attachment or not attachment? So I will take a story. This is a story of is coming in Mahabharata, and the story is about Shakuntala. You may have heard the name. Shakuntala is a name of a mother of Bharat, the great emperor Bharat, whose name is one of the reason why that whole continent name is Bharat. The name of Bharat has come from three Bharat: the emperor Bharat, the Ram's brother Bharat, and the sage Jada Bharat. From these three Bharat, the name of Bharat has come. One is an emperor, he is a sign of valor. then Ram's brother Bharat is a sign of giving away. Jo tyag, tyag ki murti. One is parakram ki murti, one is tyag ki murti, and Jad Bharat is a gyan ki murti. Tyag, gyan, and valor, parakram. These three qualities where the people are seen is the country or the continent name as Bharat. That is how the name Bharat has come. So it is expected that the people who are living there or who are born there are having these three qualities. The valor, parakram hona chahiye, tyag hona chahiye, aur gyan hona chahiye. Well, we'll talk about the rag part. We'll talk about that part. So what happened that Shakuntala is, so we'll talk about a little story about Shakuntala. What happened that there was a sage named Vishwamitra. Vishwamitra was a very big sage. And he was doing lot of tapa, penance. He was having great tapa. And because he was doing the tapa, the Indra, the king of the heaven, he was worried. Yeah, generally when the lower section of the society starts working hard and going with a more better quality, the political system is worried. They get disturbed. Yeah, this is practically the thing. Yeah, you should be in a completely in a non-thinking psychology. Yeah, people should have drugs. Yeah, allow more drugs in the society. So that they will not complain against the power. This is, if you study the political sciences, this is one of the methods. Anyway, let me stick to the story here. So, when Vishwamitra is doing lot of tapa, what happened is that Indra was worried. So Indra thought that I should break his tapa, his penance, his all hard work. So Vishwamitra, so Indra sent a girl, a very beautiful apsara, what is called as a apsara. I couldn't find a equivalent English word in it. So I found a most appropriate, I mean like near is a celestial damsel. I'm not convinced with the word, but you know, maybe somebody knows better English than me will be able to say that. But apsara, swarga ki apsara, celestial damsel, Menaka. Her name was Menaka. So Indra told Menaka, go. Or Vishwamitra ka tapa bhanga kar do. Go and disturb Vishwamitra. Deviate. Let him stop doing this penance and the tapa and let him go into a wrong direction. Let him use his resources and his energy into a wrong direction. Not in constructive. That is what he told. So Menaka comes, naturally, beautiful girl. Menaka comes and convinces and dances and this and that, all that she does. And Vishwamitra was lured. Vishwamitra was lured. Vishwamitra tap chhod diya. Vishwamitra left the penance. Vishwamitra left all his work. And he started, he indulging with the Menaka. And what was the result? The result was his penance was disturbed. He came down from his goals and he started living with Menaka. Now, one disclaimer here. I am not against any marriage institution. So please, I don't go there. Dhanya Gruhastha Ashrama. In Gita, it is told as the biggest ashram is Gruhastha Ashrama. So this is not going there. But we will stick to the story of it. So when Vishwamitra started living with Menaka, what happened is that they got a baby. And the name of the baby was Shakuntala. Shakuntala. Now how that happened? But because the baby was, once the baby was born, Menaka told that I am an apsara. I cannot be a mother of a baby. So she goes back to the heaven. And Vishwamitra says that I am a sage. I am not a sansari guy. So I will not take care of the girl. And Vishwamitra also goes away. And then it is told that the bird, who are named as a Shakunt, those birds feed the girl for a small period of time until another sage who came and who took the Shakuntala, who found the girl, baby girl in the forest and took with it. So the point here was, what is the point of the story? Imagine if there is no love, if there is no attachment, what will happen? Menaka didn't have any attachment with the baby which she gave the birth. And she goes to heaven, back again. If the world is without a love, without an attachment, will it work? There will be orphan children all around. The love, the level of greed to sometime is the force to move the people, is the force to keep the people together. Attachment is necessary. So when the God is telling here, Vita Raga Bhaya Krodha, does the God is telling that you leave the attachment? Same for the Krodha, for the anger. Somebody says that I do not get angry at all in my life. I will never get angry in my life. Will it work? Should we not feel bad and feel angry about the diminishing values in the society? Should we not feel angry when a helpless person is being harassed by other people on the side of the road? Should we not feel unhappy and angry when we feel that on one side there is a lot of food being wasted and on the other side there are so many hundreds and thousands of hungry people in the world? Should we not feel angry? Should we not feel angry within ourselves that, oh, I don't wake up in the morning and go for jogging. I don't wake up in the morning and go to the temple. I don't wake up in the morning. I don't leave my smoking habits. And we should be angry with ourselves. So it is not only anger outside, anger inside also. Unless that anger is developed, the person will not act. Why can't I leave smoking? A person, the more the angry the person is, he or she will leave the smoking. So is the anger not required? If totally anger is gone, will it work? Society will not work. We need anger. We need greed and love. And same for the bhaya, fear. Fear is the number one reason why we are all alive. We are all alive because of the fear. Fear of falling from the height. Fear from getting the burnt from the hot surfaces and the fire. Fear of eating a poisonous food and dying. All these fears kept us safe. All these fears kept us safe. So we didn't touch the fire. First fire, we may get a little burn. Yeah, next time you don't. I have a simple example on my own life. When we came first to Canada, we were not knowing that these plug points over here are always live. Back home, there are switches. You switch on and then the plug become on. Then you switch off, the plug will become off. There is no electricity in the plug. We came here on the very second day. We were not knowing all these plugs are having electricity. So on the very second day, my little daughter, she was around 2.5. She was having that metallic pin, fix the hairs. So she was having that tick-tock type of pin. And she was just moving around in the house. So she removed the pin. She thought, it seems a hole over there. I should put something in it. 2.5-year-old child. We never even expected. She removed the pin. She opened the prongs. So it opened like this, a prong. And then she put it in the plug. It gave her a spark. She naturally felt an electric shock. But because it was loose, she didn't die or anything happened. But she felt an electric shock, definitely. And the pin also got sparked and burnt. And then we were worried, oh my God, now what happens? My wife told me, we will plug all of that, we will close all of that so that she doesn't put the pin again. And she will be safe. I told that it is not necessary now. And she's asking why. I told, now she learned that there is a bhaya in it. And I proved it also. I told my daughter again, give her another pin in the hand and tell her, okay, put in this. No. I will not put it. Put it in. She will not put it. Why she will not put it? Because she knows there is a fear in it. So fear is necessary for our life. If we do not have a fear, then we would have died in childhood. All this fear has kept us alive. So when the God is telling, Vita Raga Bhaya Krodha, Bhaya, which Bhaya to go? which fear to go and which fear to stay. We should be totally fearless. We should have no fear at all in the life. No, then we will die very soon. If I don't have a fear of getting caught by crossing a red light, everybody will start driving in a crossing red light, passing a red light. What will happen? Lots of accidents. But there is a fear of law. The whole governance is by the fear. 70% of the people are following the rules only because of the fear. Government cannot go and catch every single citizen if all of them stops giving a tax. You cannot give 20 million or 40 million, you know, notices from CRA that you guys are not paying tax. If everybody stops, then the governance will become a big problem. So the fear is guiding 70% of people to follow the rules. And this, when we follow the rules, the society becomes in a good way. That is why a fear is necessary. Yeah, going to the jail for the crime. Yeah, cutting through the sharp tools when we use the hammer or any other knife. Once we get a cut, a girl is learning, suppose cutting vegetable in the kitchen with the mother. She will get one or two cuts definitely. And once she gets a cut in the finger, oh, this is knife. Now she learns how to use a knife. And she will be safe for the future. She will be having a fear how not to cut the finger or the skin. Fear is necessary. Drowning. Yeah, we go for swimming. We learn swimming. Same purpose. If we are not having a fear, we will jump in the ocean. We will die. I don't want to drown. So fear is basically the fundamental thing which keeps us alive. And same way, fear for doing wrong things. And the law of karma is also is creating a fear in the mind of a people, good people. Oh, I should do a good karma. Why? Because there will be a law. There is a law. It is going to come back to me. Yin yang. The way you do, it comes back to you. Fear. Fear is necessary. And the fear of God even. Bhagwan saja dega. Bure karmo ka phal bura hoga. This is all fear. If that fear is not there, the world will become uncontrolled. So fear is necessary. So when God is telling here us that Vita Raga Bhaya Krodha, whose fear is gone, whose krodha is gone, whose greed is gone, whose love attachment is gone, what does actually what God wants to say? Very important point. If these things are necessary, as we saw, practically it seems necessary, then in that case, what does the God wants to say here? Which of the raga, bhaya and krodha should go? If it is necessary for this life, it should be there. So the word here, important word here is the greed for the future. Which greed should go? The greed for the future should go. Mera aisa hona hi chahiye. I must get this. I must have this. Unless this is going to happen, I am going to be unhappy. That kind of a psychology and feeling should go. But the present attachment must stay. The greed for the future, the greed for the future should go. When the greed for the future goes, then the results of the future which impact us will not be there. It will come to us, but it will not make us unhappy. Why? Because we do not have the greed for it. We have worked for it. We have worked hard. We have done the actions, but we have not got the greed for it. In the same way, the anger for the past. Which anger should go? Anger for the past should go. Mere saath aisa hua tha. Somebody did an injustice to me. I was not given enough opportunity. I am today because of so and so person did a wrong thing with me. And we keep that anger in our mind. We keep thinking about that anger. most of the old people, you hear them, they will give all the sad stories. And they will say how much hard work they came through in the life. Most of the old people. They will remember all the adversaries through which they came to the present situation. And they keep thinking about it. They keep thinking about it. So even the experience in the past, the experience in the past makes them unhappy in the present. Experience in the past makes them unhappy in the present. This is what happens when we have an anger for the past. When we have an anger for the past, the experiences in the past is making our present unhappy. So when God is telling us that you leave with raga bhaya krodha, you leave the krodha, means which krodha to leave? Krodha which is for the past. Our experiences in the past, the bad experiences, the misery, adversaries, unpleasant situation, unpleasant experiences, injustice, disease, inadequate resources, all these things which created difficulty in the past, don't keep an anger on it. Leave the anger. That is the anger to be left when it is a vita raga bhaya krodha. Whose anger is gone means what? Who is not, clementing on the past. He is not angry for what happened to him in the past. Anger for the past should go. Just like the greed for the future should go, the anger for the past should go. Why anger for the past should go? Because by remembering that thing every time, you can't change the past. The only thing you can do is you can spoil your present and future happiness. That is why it is told, Adi Shankaracharya has told that Vruddhasthava Chinta Magna. A old person, the indication of aging, the signal, the property, the quality of an old person or getting old is what? Chinta Magna. He is always worried about the future, greed of the future, and anger about the past. They never live in present. When a person achieves that state of mind, that kind of a mind, he is an old person. Even though he is a 20-year-old man, even though that person is only 20-year-old, that person is old. Vruddhasthava chinta magna. That is the old person. It is not the physical old. It is the psychology of a person who is so much either in the greed of the future or anger of the past. That is what it is. Greed, anger, and fear. Which fear? Whatever we have in our present life, at present time, we have a fear. Mera paisa chala jayega to? Yeah. There are five types of fear. The fear of losing life, the fear of losing bread and butter, means the earning, the fear of losing the dignity. If there is something wrong going on, we keep mum. Why? Mai bolunga to mera apaman ho jayega. Apaman. Yeah. Loss of dignity. So loss of life. Loss of money, loss of bread and butter, earning resources, loss of dignity, loss of beloved ones. Yeah. Oh, what will happen if my father is now sick? He is going to die. I'm going to miss him. All these are fear. So fears are for present. So these three things: fear of the present, anger of the past, and greed of the future. These three raga, bhaya, and krodha should be vita. Those things should be left and not all. Because as we saw, the anger, the greed, and the fear is necessary in life. So I think I will stop over here. I've got an announcement also to be done, because we are getting in the Navratri. The great festival of Navratri is coming, and then the Diwali will be coming. So we have got lots of program in the Mandir over here. So on Saturday, October 14th, there is a Priti Puja, and that will be a big program over here. So we are not going to meet on 14th of October. And in the same way, on 21st October, we have got a Durga Havan outdoor. There will be a nice, great Havan outside, outdoor over here. So all the devotees are, you know, are invited, and they are all going to come over here and celebrate the Havan. So during those 2 days, this Pravachan will not be there. So coming Saturday, 14th, and the Saturday after, 21st, the Pravachan will be anadhyay. We will not be having Pravachan, and we will have Pravachan on 28th of October, the next Pravachan will be there. Till then, I wish everyone a good, healthy time, happy festival time of Navratri, when the Shraddh is going to finish, and I think 15th October is the start of Navratri. So I wish everyone a great time and a happy celebration. And we will come on 28th and go further with the slokas. Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kansa Chanuramardhanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagadgurum Guru Brahma Guru Vishnu Guru Devo Maheshwara Guru Sakshat Parabrahma Tasmai Sri Guruve.